Hey guys, Dylan Schumacher with Citadel Defense. And today I want to talk about lethality versus incapacitation. So what's the difference? Why does it matter? What are we talking about it for? So basically it boils down to this. In a self-defense everyday scenario, I don't really care how lethal or non-lethal my gun is, or my tool is, I should just say. What I care about is how effective it is at incapacitating someone, right? I want the tool that is going to incapacitate someone, which means stop them from doing the thing that made me need to shoot them in the first place, right? As quickly as possible. That's the tool I want. Whatever that tool is, that's the one that I want. So, unfortunately, we don't live in the world of Star Trek, right? We can't set phasers to stun. I was thinking about it today, and I was thinking, if the phaser existed and it had a stun setting, I'd probably carry that instead of a gun, because it'd be more effective at getting an immediate stop, right? So someone would say, okay, great, Dylan, well, you're in incapacitation, so why don't you just get good at jiu-jitsu or get a taser or get pepper spray or whatever? And the answer is, any other tool, when compared against a firearm, is not as effective at incapacitation, period. Full stop, end of sentence. I've watched a lot of police shooting videos, and I've seen tasers fail a lot. And pepper spray will not always be effective. Again, based on person's body composition and drugs or alcohol or whatever, or just their pure unbridled will and desire to fight, right? I'm not saying pepper spray is a bad thing. I'm not saying tasers are a bad thing. I think they're pretty worthless, okay? I'm not saying pepper spray is a bad thing. But I am saying that when it comes to betting my life on an incapacitation tool, I choose a gun. Now, second part of this. Incapacitation and lethality for firearms are correlated, right? They're directly correlated. They're not inversely correlated, meaning that the more effective a firearm is at incapacitation, the more it moves up that scale, the more lethal it gets. I don't know of any firearm where that is not the case. Rifles are the king of incapacitation, or maybe buckshot out of a shotgun in close quarters. They're also extremely more lethal when compared to handguns, right? So those are just the facts of the matter. But to be honest, I don't care how lethal or non-lethal my firearm is. That is a byproduct of getting them to stop doing the thing where they are threatening or trying to kill me, or threatening or trying to kill people that I'm with, or threatening or trying to kill random people in a mall, etc., 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 right? What we want is that immediate incapacitation. We want them to stop killing or stop doing the thing that made us start to shoot them in the first place. That's what we want. We want them to stop doing that. If they happen to die as a result, I'm okay with that. That is their choice that they made to kill people or to try to kill people. And so if they didn't make it, it's a bummer for them. If they happen to make it, again, inconsequential to me. They'll go to jail and court, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What I want them to do is stop doing it. And so I'm going to shoot them as many times as we need to do in order to get them to stop doing it, right? That's incapacitation. So I was just thinking about that. I thought it'd be quick and helpful to make a video about that, so that, hey, what we want out of our guns is we want them to be really, really good at incapacitating people. Lethality, care or don't care, not a big deal. But incapacitation, that's what we want. That's also, by the way, why we carry hollow points in our pistols, right? Or defense rounds, or whatever you want to call them, is because they're better at incapacitating than full metal jacket or round nose rounds. So, side note. Other than that, do brave deeds and endure.